ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेष्वभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवत्युत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 49, Akrura's Mission in Hastinapur, Text 20 and also 21, but we will be reciting 20. Na iha cha atyanta samvasah kasya chet kena chet sah rajan svena api dehena kim jaya Atmaja Adibhihi. Neha Chatyanta Samvasaha Kasya Chitkena Chitsaha Rajan Svena Pidehena Kimu Jayatma Jadibhihi Neha Chatyanta Samvasaha Kasya Chitkena Chitsaha Rajan Svena Pidehena Kimu Jayatma Jadibhihi Neha Chatyanta Samvasaha Kasya Chitkena Chitsaha Rajan Svena Pidehena किमु जायात्म जादिभिहि।
Mataji's.
not iha in this world cha and atyanta perpetual samvasaha association dwelling together kasyachit of anyone kenachit saha with anyone rajan o king svena with one's own api even dehena body kim u what to speak then jaya with wife atmaja children adibhihi and so on. Translation: in this world no one has any permanent relationship with anyone else, O King. We cannot stay forever even with our own body. What to speak of our wife, children and the rest? There is no purport here. We will go to the next verse, which I will chant myself. Ekah prasuyate jantuh ek eva praliyate ekon bhungte sukritam ek eva cha duskritam. Every creature is born alone and dies alone, and alone one experiences the just rewards of his good and evil deeds. Purport: the term anubhungte is significant here. Bhungte means the living being experiences, and anu means following or in sequence. In other words, we experience happiness and distress according to the moral and spiritual quality of our activities. We are responsible for what we do. Dhritarashtra was falsely and obsessively attached to his evil-minded sons, forgetting that he alone would have to suffer for his imprudent behavior. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnana Anjana Shalakaya Chakshuronmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Gura Shriyuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tamsajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langhayate Girim Yat Kripatamaham Vande Shri Gurundina Tarinam Vanchakalpatarubhyascha Kripasindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namane Gauratvishe Namaha Panchatattvatmakam Krishnam भक्तरूपस्वरूपकम् भक्तावतारं भक्ताख्यं नमामि भक्तशक्तिकम् आराध्यो भगवान् व्रजेशतनयस् तद्धाम वृंदावनम् रम्या काचिदुपासना व्रजवतो वर्गेणया कल्पिता श्रीमद्भागवतं प्रमाणममलं प्रेमापुमर्थो महान् श्रीचैतन्य महाप्रभोर्मतमिदं तत्रादरहना परः हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य भूनित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा। I'm very happy to be back again in Sri Radha Gopinath Mandir, especially on this auspicious occasion of Sri Lalita Shashti. I said Lalita Ashtami by mistake, I think, in the beginning, talking of Radha Ashtami, but it's Lalita Shashti. Actually, I will not be speaking about Srimati Lalita Devi because Madhavananda Prabhu is going to speak on Srimati Lalita Devi this afternoon. But before we begin talking about the verses for today, I'd just like to mention only one or two small points about Srimati Lalita Devi. Of course, we all know that she is one of the eight sakhis of Srimati Radharani. In fact, she is the most important assistant of Srimati Radharani in Goloka Vrindavan. And while we will hear about Srimati Lalita Devi this afternoon, an important point that we would need to ask ourselves in relation to the six Goswamis is that we as Gaudiya Vaishnavas are called Rupanugas. Why so? Why are we called followers of Rupa Goswami? Why not followers of Sanatan Goswami? Why not Sanatananugas? After all, Sanatan Goswami was the elder brother of Sri Rupa Goswami. Sri Rupa Goswami considered Sanatan Goswami to be his guru, and he says so in many places. And he also was such an important acharya for us. He has written so many important books. And being the eldest of the six Goswamis, one would think that we should be followers of Sanatan Goswami. Of course, we are followers of Sanatan Goswami. But specifically, the word that is used is Rupanuga. Ga means to go, Anu means behind or to follow. So to follow behind Rupa Goswami, in other words, to follow in his footsteps. Why so? And the answer is connected to today. Because Rupa Goswami is Rupa Goswami in Gaur Leela. In Krishna Leela, in Goloka Vrindavan, he is Rupa Manjari. As you are aware, the Manjaris are assistants to the Sakhis or the Gopis. They are younger in age and they perform many, many types of services to back up. They do the backup service for the pleasure of Radha and Krishna. They do not directly serve Radha and Krishna, usually. Sometimes they do, but usually that is left for the intimate circle of the eight sakhis and then of course in the sakhyaras, the cowherd boys and so on. So Rupa Manjari is one of the foremost assistants of Lalita Sakhi. Lalita Sakhi is the foremost assistant of Srimati Radharani. And as Gaudiya Vaishnavas, we aspire for the mercy of Srimati Radharani. And most of our acharyas have been in their Krishna Swarup, in their Goloka Swarup, they have been Manjaris. So therefore, for us, Rupa Goswami is considered so important because of the connection to Lalita Sakhi. And therefore, we are called Rupanugas. The mood of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is coming down through Rupa Goswami. Therefore, it is Rupa Goswami who actually understands the inner heart of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But more of that this afternoon. So here, in this section of the 49th chapter of the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, we are seeing Akrura, the paternal uncle of Sri Krishna, admonishing Dhritarashtra. Akrura speaks elaborate philosophy every now and then, just like all the great devotees of the Lord do. And here also he's speaking basic Bhagavad Gita philosophy to Dhritarashtra. Not that Dhritarashtra doesn't know it, but he needs to hear it still. That is why Srila Prabhupada would again and again, practically in every lecture, speak about us being the soul and not the body. And many times when we hear Srila Prabhupada's lecture, we may sometimes feel, why is Srila Prabhupada repeating the same thing again and again and again? We know we are not the body. We know we are the eternal soul. But the fact of the matter is that we tend to forget. Because the bodily conception of life is so strong that we need to be reminded about it every now and then. And because the power of illusion, of Maya, keeps us attached to the bodily conception of life, so it is necessary to hear this again and again, repeatedly. Mrityur janma vatam vira dehena sahajayate. This is one of the arguments that Vasudev gives to Kamsa when they are on the chariot soon after the marriage of Vasudev and Devaki. And when the voice from the sky, the Akashvani, announces that, oh foolish Kamsa, you are taking your sister to the house of her husband with great affection, but you do not know that her eighth son is going to be the cause of your death. And that infuriates Kamsa. And because he's essentially a demon, one cannot really rely upon such people. At one moment, they may be very, very nice to us, and the next moment, when they see their sense gratification being interfered with, they may become vicious with us. So Kamsa was furious and was about to kill Devaki with an upraised sword in hand. And somehow or the other, with some quick thinking on his feet, Vasudev started giving various types of arguments to Kamsa to dissuade him from this heinous act. And ultimately he was giving all kinds of philosophies, including this one, where he says that, oh hero, Ultimately, Mrityur Janmavatam Vira Dehena Sahajayate. So death is born at birth. In other words, when at the moment we are born, we are certain that death will come. So why are you trying to unnecessarily avoid your death? It will come at its destined time. So do not try to take shelter of adharma and try to avoid that which is inevitable. Of course, later when philosophy doesn't work, then Vasudeva has to promise that he will hand over all the sons that are born to him and Devaki to Kamsa. So yes, death is inevitable, and death will ultimately be the disruption of all the relationships that we have in this world. It is the ultimate termination of all our ambitions and plans and all our relationships as well. However, relationships may also get terminated before that. And we see this happening so many times in this world. We are friendly with somebody for a while, and then for some reason that friendship is broken and enmity develops with them. And then we go on to another friend, and perhaps after some time we develop some enmity with that friend as well. This happens so many times in the world around us. So relationships indeed are very, very short-lived in this world. And that is what Akrura is saying here. Na iha cha atyanta samvasaha kasyachit kenachit saha. So there is nothing in this world that is atyanta, that is permanent, that is perpetual. No relationships will last in this world. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, we see the analogy of little twigs and pieces of grass floating along a river, moved along by the flow of the river, and different twigs and grasses and pieces of blades of grass come together for a while, then they are dispersed, never to meet again, and then another group or bunch of twigs and blades of grass are brought together by the flow of the water. Then they are dispersed again, never to meet again. In this way, different living entities come together according to their karma, under the superintendence of the time factor, the flow of time. And certain living entities come together as family, as friends, as enemies, and so on. And then are dispersed, never to meet again. Similarly, another example given in the Bhagavatam is of travelers coming together at a place where drinking water is available. They all gather together, perhaps exchange some pleasantries, and then move on, never to meet again. Similarly, we are here together, unfortunately not always to exchange pleasantries. We also end up having bitterness with people around us many times. And of course, in this age of Kali, dysfunctional relationships are the hallmark, the characteristic of this age, where everybody is very, very unfortunate, and where relationships get strained for the slightest reason, and many times even for no reason. So Akrura is advising Dhritarashtra that he must think about spiritual relationships and spiritual understanding. He should cease being attached to his evil son, Duryodhana, and he should do justice to the Pandavas. He should not render injustice to them, that would be very, very adharmic. And then he says here also, ekah prasuyate jantuhu eka eva praliyate. Every creature is born alone and dies alone. Alone we come into the world and alone we leave this world. Srila Prabhupada also gave the example one time. An instructor may be there to teach us how to fly an aeroplane. But eventually a time comes when we are on our own and we are up there and the instructor is not with us and we have to manage with whatever we have learnt. So when we leave this world, then even though physically people may be with us, but still we have to cross that barrier ourselves with our consciousness. If we are thinking of Krishna at that time, then we will be successful in crossing over that barrier. If not, we will have to take birth again. Akrura's mission is very important. And as far as I remember, because actually I read up some other verse by mistake. So these verses... So Akrura's mission to Hastinapur is important because as far as I can remember, this is the first instance where Krishna's connection to the Pandavas is being brought out explicitly. You see, from the Mahabharata we understand that the first time Krishna and Balaram physically saw Arjun and the other Pandavas was at the Swayamvara ceremony of Draupadi. As you know, the Pandavas were in exile at that time and they were actually in Agyatavas. They had changed their clothes, they had dressed like Brahmanas and they were living in Ekachakra. And when they heard news about the Swayamvara of Draupadi, the daughter of King Drupada, they went there disguised as Brahmanas. They didn't look like Brahmanas because of their build and the marks of the bows on their shoulders, but because they were dressed as Brahmanas, so therefore everybody accepted them as Brahmanas. And Drupad wanted somebody very, very qualified for his daughter. So he had arranged a competition where they would have to, the potential suitors for Panchali or Draupadi would come, they would have to string a bow and shoot an arrow looking at a reflection of a fish in the water, and the fish was up on a pole and it was rotating and they had to pierce the fish with their arrows. Most of the suitors, even though they were very powerful Kshatriyas, were not even able to raise the bow, what to speak of string it. Some were able to raise it and not string it, and some, when they tried to string it, it was so tight that it rebounded and they fell back on the ground. And there was much smirking and giggling. Everybody was nervous to come up, but when they saw the failure of others, they got some hope that maybe I can succeed where this person has failed. So anyway, it was Arjuna disguised as a Brahmana who came up, and then he easily lifted the bow, strung it, and then looked into the water and also easily shot his arrow and was successful. When this was going on, Krishna and Balaram were sitting in the audience and they were watching. And Vyasadeva narrates the conversation between Krishna and Balaram. And Krishna tells Balaram, "Balaram, you know what I think? I think this is Arjuna." And Balaram also says, "Really? Okay, let me see. Who is that? Yes, I think you're right, Krishna. This is Arjuna. But they're dressed as Brahmanas. Yes, so they've come in disguise." So anyway, this is the first time in the record, so to speak, in the Prakat Leela, that Krishna and Balaram see Arjuna and the Pandavas. The Pandavas are not so much present there physically. Arjuna comes there alone. And then a little later, of course, all hell breaks loose because all the Kshatriyas there feel very offended. How can a Brahmana come here and take the hand of Draupadi? We are Kshatriyas and we are meant to be wedded to Draupadi. So they all come forward. There's a tumult over there. And finally, everybody has to come forward, and Krishna also has to come and pacify everyone and say, look, he won the hand of Draupadi fair and square. He lifted the bow, he fulfilled the conditions of Maharaj Drupad, and you didn't. There was still a battle that went on. And in the meanwhile, Arjuna whisked away Panchali and took her away in the commotion that was going on. And then you know the story, he took her back to the place where they were staying in the hut. And Kunti Maharani was there. And Yudhishthir was accompanying Arjuna and said, Mother, look what we have brought. And Kunti said, whatever it is, you share it equally amongst all of you. And Yudhishthir said, oh, what have you said? And then Yudhishthir goes inside and Mother Kunti is aghast. Oh, what did I say? And then Yudhishthir says, but Mother, your word must come true. We cannot break your word. So there is a lot of dharma sankat there, some difficulty in terms of the intricacies of dharma, because dharma is very, very intricate, very difficult to understand. The ways of dharma in this world are actually inconceivable. And so there's a lot of discussion that goes on, and eventually Vyasadeva comes there. And then casually Krishna also walks in. He saunters in. And then Arjuna and Krishna see and they recognize Krishna. So that's the first time that they actually see Krishna in the Prakat Leela. So this verse here actually indicates that even much before the Swayamvara ceremony of Draupadi or Panchali, Krishna was very much in tune with what was happening in Hastinapur. He was keeping himself informed. And this is an example of how he was keeping himself informed. He sent Akrura, his paternal uncle, as his messenger to go and find out what was happening. He wanted to pacify Queen Kunti because she was very distraught with grief. And this episode also appears when Akrura goes to Queen Kunti and then she actually laments that, oh, has Krishna, in the previous verses, has Krishna forgotten us? And Akrura pacifies her. He hears from her all the distresses that they have, she and the Pandavas have undergone under the rule and watchful, not so watchful eye rather, of Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra should have stepped in between and ensured that there was no injustice to the queen, to the wife and the sons of Pandu. But Dhritarashtra, out of false affection for his evil son Duryodhana, did not intervene. And this was a cause of great grief. As the Antaryami, one who is situated in everybody's heart, Krishna of course knew everything. But nevertheless, he wanted to have information coming in through his sources, other sources as well. So then Akrura goes and finds out what's happening, spends a good amount of time in Hastinapur, meets everybody, tries to understand how the Pandavas are, how Mother Kunti is, and then he comes back and gives the information to Krishna. And actually Krishna gives a veiled threat even. At that time, an Akrura gives information. So Krishna is very much aware of the sufferings of the Pandavas. His heart goes out to them. At the same time, the Pandavas are about to play a very, very important role in Krishna's pastimes. And what the Pandavas are going through is necessary for the effective fulfillment of those pastimes, which are also meant to fulfill certain purposes that Krishna has in mind. Krishna is about to use in the near future the Pandavas as his instruments to effect his will. And therefore, the Pandavas' suffering should not be considered ordinary suffering. the great devotees like the Pandavas and Prahlads suffer or apparently suffer not because of their karma but because it is Krishna's will. Even in the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam we see Bhishma Dev getting perplexed about why the Pandavas should be suffering so much. Bhishma Deva is a Mahajan. He is a great authority on scripture, on dharma, so much so that Krishna wants Maharaj Yudhishthir to be instructed by Bhishma Dev when Bhishma Dev is lying on the bed of arrows. It was to glorify Bhishma that Krishna arranged things in such a way that Bhishma would not depart from this world till he had done this important service of giving shiksha or instruction to Maharaj Yudhishthir on many, many important topics. So Bhishma Dev was also perplexed. Why is it that you Pandavas have been suffering like this? It is inconceivable. You have never done anything sinful. You have always been virtuous. So even from a material point of view, from an ordinary dharmic point of view, there is no flaw. And still you are suffering. And even from the point of view of spiritual perspectives, Krishna is here as your cousin. He is your constant companion. And still you have been suffering. So I can understand that the only reason this is happening is because of the time factor. And then Srila Prabhupada explains what the time factor means. The time factor means it is the will of Krishna. Because Krishna actually wanted that to happen to demonstrate to the world how the pure devotees of the Lord never forget Krishna even in the most difficult circumstances. In fact, their love for the Lord only becomes deeper and deeper in difficult circumstances. For us, our sorrows and tribulations are very small compared to the trials that the Pandavas had to undergo. So when we look at the consciousness of the Pandavas and their deep devotion for Krishna, even in the midst of these difficulties, we can get some inspiration that we should not give up Krishna consciousness at any cost, whatever may be the difficulties that come in our life. Also, Krishna sometimes puts his devotees into difficulties to increase their sense of surrender and dependence on him and to increase the intensity of their love for him. So these are the reasons that Krishna puts his devotees into difficulty, and at the same time he has them in mind for effecting certain missions that he has descended in this world to fulfill. If Arjuna was not there, Bhagavad Gita would not be spoken. If this whole injustice to the Pandavas was not there, what would be the need for a battle? What would be the need for Bhagavad Gita to be spoken? And since Krishna is here for the purpose of establishing dharma, dharma sansthapanarthaya, so all these pastimes were necessary. So Akrura had this mission. He often acts as a messenger. He did so even for Kamsa. Kamsa sent Akrura to Vrindavan. Akrura, you are my trusted minister and I have an ambition to be the emperor of the world. And this Krishna and Balaram in Vrindavan, they are like thorns in my path. Because just before that, Narad Muni had explained the truth to Kamsa. He had told him, Kamsa, you are a fool. You do not know that the eighth son of Devaki, who has been prophesied to be the cause of your death is very much around. He is none other than Krishna. You think that he is a son of Yashoda, but actually he is the eighth son of Devaki. And Balaram is a son of Vasudeva and Rohini, and he is also living with Krishna in Vrindavan. And then Narad Muni riles Kamsa all up, and Kamsa once again becomes very upset. Narad Muni is also playing a very useful role. He is also facilitating Krishna's pastimes because he wants Krishna now to move on from Vrindavan to Mathura, carry on with his pastimes. And he wants to expedite, or he wants to hasten the killing of the demons led by Kamsa, which is anyway the purpose for which Krishna has descended. So Narad Muni acts as an agent. So at Narad Muni's provocation, Kamsa now decided that this was it. He called Akrura and said, please go on to Vrindavan and call Krishna and Balaram here on the pretext of a Dhanur Yajna, of a bow sacrifice, and we will have a big festival over here. So just like we nowadays have sports competitions in big stadia, so in those days there were such festivals also going on. Dhanur Yajna, different types of religious observances, and also such sports as wrestling and so on. Kamsa's idea was, of course, that he wanted to kill Krishna and Balaram. And he had what he thought was a foolproof plan. At every stage he had made arrangements to kill Krishna. But naturally it wasn't Krishna who was killed, it was Kamsa who was killed. So Akrura had come as a messenger of Krishna. Akrura and some others had remained behind in Mathura. They had not fled, because when Kamsa began his atrocities on the Yadus and the Bhojas and the Andhakas and Vrishnis and so on, many of them had fled to different parts of the country. But a few, like Akrura, had remained, because they understood that was the Lord's plan. They wanted to participate in Krishna's pastimes when he would come to Mathura. They wanted to witness those pastimes with their own eyes. So Akrura remained behind. And here he was sent for this very, very important service as a messenger of Kamsa. Of course, he became most unpopular with the residents of Vrindavan. And the gopis in particular, they heartily admonished Akrura and said, we don't know how you got the name Akrura, because Akrura means one who is not krura, or who is not cruel. But you are cruel, so you are actually krura, not Akrura, because you are taking away Krishna from us. You are making us blind. How was Akrura going to make the gopis blind? Because the gopis said that the purpose of our eyes is to see Krishna. There is no other purpose. Our eyes are only seeing Krishna. And now that you take Krishna away from us, what use is left for these eyes? So we might as well be blind. We are as good as blind, because there is no other object of vision for our eyes save and except Sri Krishna. So they were admonishing Akrura. They were admonishing the creator of the world. They were admonishing destiny. And after Akrura takes away Krishna, and in the process also actually the gopis keep interfering, they come in the way. There are many pastimes, the local Brajavasis in Braj narrate about how the gopis kept running from place to place to intercept the chariot on which Akrura was taking Krishna and Balaram to Mathura. And different villages are still called by names that are connected to this pastime. There is a village in Braj called Si. And it is a distortion of the word Shigra, where Krishna told the gopis, I will come back very soon, Shigram. So because that's the place Krishna said, I will come back soon, Shigram, so somehow over the years the name has become Si. There's another village there called Parsom, because Krishna said, I will come back Parsom, which means day after tomorrow. So there's a village there called Parsom. So from Nandagaon all the way to Mathura is not such a long distance actually. But it took Akrura practically the whole day to reach Mathura. And actually it did even for him to come from Mathura to Vrindavan. Mathura to Vrindavan also is not so far. So why did it take Akrura in the first place the whole day to go from Mathura to Vrindavan? Because Akrura was so ecstatic in his expectation of seeing Krishna in a short time that he was besides himself with joy and he didn't know what he was doing. So he sat on the chariot and the horses had free rein, free play. The horses were moving wherever they wanted. And Akrura was just sitting there absorbed in thoughts of Krishna. When I go to Vrindavan, when I reach there, this is what I'm going to do, this is how I'm going to offer obeisances. So these prayers of Akrura are of course celebrated as very wonderful prayers. And indeed, in the Navadha Bhakti process, the ninefold devotional service, Akrura is considered an example of having attained perfection through the process of Vandana or offering prayers. So Akrura sets a perfect example for us about how we should approach Vrindavan. What should be our consciousness? What should be our mentality? What kinds of prayers should we offer? What should be our aspirations? So Akrura was completely in a state of bhava, in a state of ecstatic absorption in remembrance of the Lord. And as he approached the outskirts, he saw Krishna's transcendental footprints imprinted in the sands of Brajabhumi. Upon recognizing those footprints which had the characteristic marks like the thunderbolt, the lotus and so on, he immediately got down and began rolling in the sand. So by the time the horses somehow managed to reach Vrindavan, it was evening. So Akrura was given the instruction on the night of Ekadashi, and in the morning of Dwadashi he started, and it was on the late evening of Dwadashi that he reached Braj, and he actually met Krishna and Balaram. He rested for the night, and the next morning he took Krishna and Balaram back. So Akrura's role as a messenger is a very crucial one. And we see, because that's connected to his topic as a messenger of Krishna this time to Dhritarashtra. As a messenger of Krishna to Dhritarashtra, he's talking about the futility and the short-lived nature of relationships in this world. And when Akrura came as a messenger of Kamsa, he also gave a similar message. That what to speak of us ordinary folks, even the relationship of Krishna with his devotees in the Prakat Leela, in the manifest pastimes, is also short-lived. Now this is a very important and interesting point. When Krishna was born or he appeared in Mathura, he was immediately transferred to Gokul by Vasudev. He lived in Braja, first in Vrindavan, then in Chatikara, and then in Nandagaon, totally for about 10.5 years. So when Akrura came to pick him up, to take him to Mathura, Krishna was about 10.5 years old. Then he moved on to Mathura. He lived there for another 18 years or so, till the age of 28. And then he moved on to Dwarka, and he lived till the age of 125, in between going and coming to different places. So the relationships of the Brajabasis with Krishna, from an ordinary worldly point of view, was short-lived. Only 10.5 years. We can only imagine the intensity of the pain the Brajabasis felt at Krishna's impending departure and also subsequent to his departure. Because the Brajabasis are considered the topmost exemplars of devotional service. Nobody can render devotional service like the Brajabasis do. Because of the sweetness and intimacy of their love for Krishna, they are unparalleled. And yet, Krishna was with them only for 10.5 years. And he was with his Mathura associates for the rest of his lifespan. His Prakat Leela, manifest pastimes, because the residents of Mathura were also transferred by him to Dwarka. So we see that even though in the spiritual world, the associates of Krishna live eternally with him, there is no separation, but here there seems to be a separation. Why so? The answer is that this is the difference between Aprakat Leela and Prakat Leela. The Acharyas have explained that there are two kinds of pastimes of the Lord. One are the pastimes that go on in the spiritual world, which are uninterrupted, like continuous flow of nectar going on from time without beginning and continuing on till time without end. So that continuous flow of pastimes is going on in the spiritual world. It is called aprakat or unmanifest because we cannot see it with these eyes. When Krishna descends to this world, he incarnates and he appears here. He also brings the holy abode from the spiritual world to the material world. Identical, the Vrindavan that is found here is identical to the Vrindavan that exists in the spiritual world. To distinguish between the two, however, the terms used are Paravyoma Vrindavan and Bhauma Vrindavan. Paravyoma means the spiritual sky, and Bhauma means that which is on Bhumi or earth. So even though the two are identical, but there is a difference in the nature of the pastimes performed in these two abodes. In the Paravyoma Vrindavan, we have only the Aprakat Leela going on. And for them, it is constantly Prakat. It is constantly manifest. It is unmanifest from our point of view, living here in the material world. But for them, it is always manifest. However, when Krishna descends here to Bhauma Vrindavan, then his, and in the earth in general, his pastimes are sometimes manifest and sometimes not manifest. So when they are manifest, in other words, when everybody can see Krishna with their physical eyes, then those pastimes are considered Prakat Leela, manifest pastimes. And when those pastimes cease to be seen by ordinary eyes, then Krishna's pastimes still continue in Vrindavan, but they are called Aprakat Leela. Vrindavanam parityajya padamekam na gacchati. So Krishna never leaves Vrindavan, never takes one step outside of Vrindavan. So then how did Akrura succeed in taking Krishna and Balaram out of Vrindavan to Mathura? And why did he do that in the first place? This is the important question. Actually, a couple of questions come up or emerge at this point, especially when we are talking of short-lived relationships in this world. Because Krishna is performing those pastimes in the material world, although actually Vrindavan, Mathura are the spiritual world, but because they have manifested within the material world, Krishna cannot let them continue indefinitely at the manifest platform. So he has to terminate these pastimes on the manifest level from time to time. So therefore he can't continue with his Prakat Leela in Vrindavan forever and ever. He has to move on to Mathura, he has to move on to Dwarka. The question that arises, which Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, one of our great acharyas, asks, and then he answers it also, is generally we like to stay in a place where we are loved, and we don't like to leave that place. Now, in no other place do the devotees love Krishna with as much intensity and sweetness as they do in Vrindavan. Then why did Krishna leave Vrindavan? Why did Krishna agree to Kamsa's proposal and Akrura's request? The second question that arises is, all right, he left, but when he left, he promised the gopis, Ayasye, I will come back. He said, I will come back, so why did he not come back? Elsewhere in the scriptures it is said that Krishna is Satya Sankalpa, that when he speaks that something, he sticks to it, he sticks to his word, he is always truthful. Every action of his is full of truth. So why did he not come back? So these are important questions that come to mind. Another question that comes to mind is, if the love of the Brajabasis for Krishna is so sublime, then all Krishna had to do was to transfer the Brajabasis from Vrindavan to Mathura. After all, he did the same thing for the residents of Mathura. One fine day, when the residents of Mathura had gone to sleep, then Krishna used his Yogamaya potency, and the next morning when the Mathura Vasis woke up, they had become Dwarka Vasis. They woke up in Dwarka. So Krishna transferred all the residents of Mathura to Dwarka. So could he not do the same? Then the gopis and the other Brajabasis, Mother Yashoda, Nanda Maharaj, would also have been with him in Mathura and later in Dwarka. So what was the difficulty? Why did Krishna's relationship with the Brajabasis have to be short-lived? Why this pain? Well, it wasn't just like an ordinary mundane relationship. One reason, of course, is to remind us that all relationships in this world are temporary. So Krishna's Prakat Leela relationships are also temporary. So we are reminded of the pain that is caused in this material world. Therefore, our aspiration should be to serve Krishna nicely. And eventually Krishna, of course, will take us to the spiritual world and we will be eternally with him, never to be separated from him and his devotees. Another reason for Krishna terminating his Prakat Leela and going to Mathura is that this was Narad Muni's request. Just around the time that Krishna had killed Keshi and Vyomasura, Narad Muni had also come to Vrindavan. And he had done his business with Kamsa. Now he had to do his business with Krishna as well. So he told Krishna, he glorified him and started narrating all his pastimes that he had performed in Vrindavan. And then he went on to narrate Krishna's pastimes that were yet to be performed in Mathura and Dwarka. Even though Krishna had not yet left Vrindavan. But Narad Muni was empowered by the Lord with Trikalagnyata, which means the potency to see past, present and future. So he could understand that these were the pastimes that Krishna would perform in Mathura, the principal pastimes, and in Dwarka as well. And he started narrating them. My Lord, when you go to Mathura, you will kill this demon and that demon, you will do this, and then in Dwarka you will do this. So then Krishna is thinking, okay, so this is the instruction of my devotee. So that means I must actually do it now. Since Narad Muni is instructing me, how can I refuse? This is how great Narad Muni is. So Krishna then decides, all right, now I have to leave Vrindavan. Time has come. Although these residents of Vrindavan are so loving, and I really don't want to leave them, neither do they want to leave me. After all, who wants to leave a place where one is loved? But duty calls. I must also answer to devotees like Narad Muni. And also, Narad Muni is asking me to come because he wants me to fulfill the purposes for which I have advented into this world. I advented at the request of the demigods who wanted me to kill the demons, to establish dharma, to protect the devotees. So I have to move on now. So Krishna, therefore, with a heavy heart, moved on to Mathura. So this is an explanation of why Krishna moved from Vrindavan to Mathura. Also, he wanted to make the love of the Brajabasis for him especially deeper and more intense. In particular, he was focusing on those Brajabasis who had performed devotional service within this material world for many lives and had now become eligible to participate in Krishna's pastimes in Bhauma Vrindavan, in the association of the eternal associates of Krishna who had descended from the spiritual world with Krishna. They would get trained in the finer nuances of devotional service and they would become ready to go back to Goloka Vrindavan. You see, it is explained that when one becomes a pure devotee, one after death does not immediately go to Goloka Vrindavan or Paravyoma Vrindavan. One goes to Bhauma Vrindavan somewhere, in some universe, in this material world. One takes birth as a Brajabasi, according to one's particular relationship with Krishna. There, one is given an orientation course, the VTA and the BT. One is prepared for entrance into Paravyoma Vrindavan. One is taught the intricacies and nuances of how Krishna and Radharani have to be served in Goloka Vrindavan. So these sadhana siddha devotees, they learn what devotional service really is over there by looking at these Nitya Siddha associates of Krishna. Then they also become completely purified of whatever atomic impurities may have still remained in very subtle form. So it is particularly towards these associates that Krishna targets, and he wants their devotion to become completely as good as the devotion of the Nitya Siddha associates of Krishna. He wants their love to become very, very deep, and that can happen by separation. So this Vipralambha or this Viraha is very, very important. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that when Akrura manages to take Krishna and Balaram out of Vrindavan, I think it's the 39th chapter, and then I think in the 40th chapter, the gopis recite some verses. And he says, the Acharya says, that these verses are called the Viraha Geet. They are songs sung in separation because they express the deep separation the gopis are feeling for Krishna. So this feeling of separation embodies the most intense form of devotion to Krishna. And that is actually Krishna's purpose. because he wants to intensify and sweeten further the love of the Brajabasis for him. So this answers the first question, that even though Krishna was in Vrindavan, in the midst of his most loving devotees, why did he leave Vrindavan to go to Mathura? The second question, of course, is equally important. Yes, the third question, why did he not transfer the residence of Vrindavan to Mathura? The answer being that the moods in Vrindavan and Mathura are different. In Vrindavan, Nanda Baba and Mother Yashoda never considered Krishna to be God. They always considered Krishna to be their son. The cowherd boys always thought of Krishna as their friend. The gopis always thought of Krishna as their lover. Even if it was brought to their attention that the person whom they considered to be their son or friend or lover was God, it didn't really affect the sweetness of their love for Krishna. Whereas that was not the case in Mathura. When Devaki and Vasudev saw Krishna killing Kamsa, Chanur, Mushtik, Kovalyapir, they heard about his killing that mad elephant, and they saw this display of extraordinary prowess, they started thinking of Krishna as God, and their Vatsalya Prema, or their love for Krishna in the mood of parental affection, was compromised, was diminished. They did not like it. They started worshipping Krishna with some awe and reverence now, and Krishna did not like this. So he once again had Yoga Maya put the covering of illusion, of Yoga Maya, before the eyes of Vasudeva and Devaki, and once again they considered Krishna as their, and Balaram as their children. So if Yashoda and Nanda Baba were brought to Mathura, that would have been first of all a very awkward situation, two sets of parents. So whom should one give affection to? So even from an ordinary point of view, we can understand the awkwardness of the situation. And from a point of view of transcendental rasa, it would have been again awkward, because the mood of Vrindavan and the mood of Mathura was different. That is the reason that Krishna did not transfer the residence of Vrindavan to Mathura. They remained there. But actually, we come now to the third, the last question, which is that why did Krishna not come back to Vrindavan? Since he said, Ayasye, I will come back, and Krishna's Satya Sankalpa, why did he not come back? Does it mean that he spoke a lie? The Srimad Bhagavatam does not talk about Krishna's return to Vrindavan. Once he left Vrindavan, that was it. Balaram came back and stayed with the Brajabasis for 2 months. He came at the request of Krishna, because Krishna wanted the residents of Vrindavan to be pacified. And who better than Balaram to do it? So Balaram came. That is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. But about Krishna's return to Vrindavan, that is not mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. However, Srila Jiva Goswami mentions that in the Padma Purana, there is a description that after killing Dantavakra, when now most of the demons on the earth had been destroyed, and Krishna's work had been accomplished, he actually delivered, he sent the residents of Vrindavan to Goloka Vrindavan. He sent them all off to Goloka Vrindavan. And Jiva Goswami mentions that he came back at that time to Vrindavan after the killing of Dwarka, killing of Dantavakra. So then, yes, he was Satyasankalpa. He came. And in another sense, we can understand that because Krishna was present in Vrindavan in his aprakat form, in his unmanifest pastimes, he actually never left Vrindavan. So therefore, he wasn't false when he said, I will come back, because he never left. So therefore, he was there in Vrindavan. His unmanifest pastimes continued. And this is again another important role for Akrura to play. When Akrura took Krishna and Balaram to Mathura, they had to cross, they came to the Yamuna first, at the place that is called Akrur Ghat. And at Akrur Ghat, you know the famous pastime of Akrura seeing Krishna as Mahavishnu and Balaram as Anantashesh. And the purport to this pastime is that this is that transcendental boundary between Vrindavan and Mathura. Now Krishna, who is a son of Mother Yashoda, never crosses this boundary line. He always lives eternally in Vrindavan, relishing the love of Mother Yashoda and Nanda Baba, the cowherd boys, the gopis, the cows. So then who went on to Mathura and later to Dwarka? It was Krishna, but Krishna's expansion, who was Devaki Nandan, Vasudev Suta. So this was the point at which Krishna and Balaram remained behind in Vrindavan in their aprakat forms, and their prakat forms were now of Mathura. It was Sankarshan who expanded himself, and Vasudev Suta, Devaki Nandan. And they went on to perform their pastimes there, and Krishna and Balaram remained here in the association of the Brajabasis at an aprakata level, unmanifest pastime. So in a sense, in this transcendental relationship, there is no termination. We all want family life, and the family life that is seen here in this world is a perverted reflection of the real family life that exists in Goloka Vrindavan in the spiritual world. Family relationships here will get terminated, and often there is bitterness as well, but the real family life for which we all aspire is there in Paravyoma Goloka Vrindavan. And there the relationships will never end. But Krishna reminds us that when I come to the material world, even though it is Vrindavan, but because I'm manifesting these pastimes in the material world, they have to end. But if you want relationship with me and my devotees that will never end, then you have to come back to Goloka Vrindavan. You have to prepare yourself for that. So that is what Krishna consciousness is all about. Even though the pure devotee actually never insists that I want to be there, the pure devotee is happy being wherever Krishna wants him or her to be. Even if Krishna wants the devotee to go to some hellish planet to preach and distribute books, the devotee would be willing to go there. But Krishna, out of his affection, will certainly take the pure devotee back to join him in his eternal family life. The one big joint family that exists in Goloka Vrindavan, where the relationships are never ever terminated. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.